Okay, so we have a talk now from Nicolas Montavant, so if you want to come here.
Allo, 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 allo. Yes? Yes. It's working.
Oh man, what are you doing here?
You can stay. You can stay. Huh? Yeah.
You want to talk?
Yeah, sure.
Don't sleep.
So. Don't snore too loud. I mean, where's IMT? So you can like, put your IMT color.
Okay. Don't worry, it's a serial bus. Okay, so we are not coming that much. We're going to start. People will
come. You will see.
The next talk is starting. Please come down now. Please come over.
Yes.
Next talk, please come over. Everybody who wants to listen, please come over for the next talk. I love the director. He carries his heart open.
Okay, so thank you to be here, and it's a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Nicolas Montavant, or Professor Nicolas Montavant, from IMT Atlantic. So it's a double pleasure for me, first because he's my boss, and the second one because he will make a very great talk on routing in industrial networks. So Nicolas is IMT Atlantic. He worked a lot in ITS, so Intelligent Transport System, and was very well known on mobile IP, and he was chair of a group at the ITF on this. After that, he worked also on handover on Wi-Fi and make a lot of very interesting study about planification of a Wi-Fi network. And more recently, he became at the head of the OSIF department, so connected object and in future internet at IMT Atlantic, and is now working on smart grids and also industrial network. So he will present this in his talk.
Thank you very much. That was quite long. So yes, today my talk will be about industrial IoT for Internet of Things. And I will present you how we can use the Internet of Things, so sensors, actuators, in a real environment connected to the internet, and also providing not only best effort service for the communication, but quality of service up to deterministic network. I will explain what this is. In this presentation, I will be focusing on wireless communication and the protocol for that, so layer 2 and layer 3. I prepared this slide with my colleagues, so some of the slides are even from them. So Yorgos, who is here, and our PhD student, Thomas and Guillaume. So let me start with the different use cases that on which we are working in our lab. So that's one first use case, and it's about electric vehicles. So I don't know if you know much about this, but in France, it's a market that is growing very much. Renault in particular, for example, is doing electric car for a long time, and they start to be very good. So that's an example of one of them. And why are we interested in this? It's because we are trying to see if the Internet of Things can come into the picture in this environment. And you can see here, usually it's on the floor of the car, it's the battery. And the battery is the most expensive component of the electric car. It costs like a quarter of the value of the car, something like that. And it's quite big. And inside this battery, you have a system that looks like this. You have many different cells that you can see here. Each of them is 3.7 volts. And in total, the battery delivers 400 volts. So there are many, many cells. And you need to monitor these cells, because they can explode, for example, if they are not at the good temperature. So you monitor the voltage, you monitor the temperature, the current, and then you need also some control over these cells to balance the load, because by default, when you charge and discharge the different cells, this distributed system, they get unbalanced, which means that some cells have less power than others. And you need to equilibrate again these different cells. So you have a master controller here. It's not connected. Yes. The master controller here. And so that's the sensor unit, if you want, that monitors some cells. And then they communicate with the master controller here. And what we are doing here is replacing these wires, these wired, by wireless communication. So you can directly communicate from the CSU here, the monitoring element, to the master that is here. So we did several tests, first with only the wireless cards in a desk, then in a metallic box to try to reproduce the environment. And then we went more and more into the car. So we have an open source vehicle that you can see here, that we can drive and we can test several things. Here, it's not a commercial vehicle, so you can see that the battery is here in the front and in the back and below our seats. And we plugged the wireless device to this battery to see if it was working in a in almost the real environment. And then we went to a prototype vehicle where you can see here the battery is also on the floor. You can remove it like this with the trolley. And we put different sensor here, and we also use the wireless communication. So for that, for example, you need a very efficient wireless communications between the device, because you need to send the values that I told you, the temperature, the voltage, every 20 milliseconds. And it needs to be sharp, no delay. Every 20 milliseconds, you need to have the information. Another use case on which we are working for many years now is the smart grid. So the smart grid is the evolution of the grid in many countries, where you have different aspects in this evolution. One of them is the introduction of renewable energy into the framework. So instead of having few very big production units, you have many, many distributed production units, like solar panels that you can deploy in fields or in the roof of the houses. And once you have that, you won't have the energy available all the time. So you have intermittent production. So you need to manage this production, and you need to make the consumption in line with the production. So for that, you need a very strong information system, an ICT system, where the different elements can communicate together to say when the energy is available, when it's not, when you need the energy, and so on. So in this context, we work on what we call nanogrid. So it's, you can consider like a house or a building with apartments or some houses in a given area. And you have like these different houses with solar panels, for example, that generate energy not all the time, but at some time. And then we equipped all the appliances inside the home, and we can launch these devices depending on the available energy. And you can also have communications between the apartments or the home to negotiate the prices of the energy and try to consume the energy when it's produced and then when it's cheaper. Well, now let's go on the technical details. So there are two use cases on which we apply what I'm going to show you here. So the outline of the rest of the presentation is the following. I'll have a short introduction, and then I will focus, as I said, on two technologies, the two layers. The first one is the MAC layer, layer 2, on 802.15 with the TSCH mode. I will explain what this is later. And on the layer 3 then, which is the routing layer, with the protocol that is called RPL, we say Ripple. And then I will move forward to how can we provide deterministic networking for the IoT with these two technologies. So what's the industrial IoT? Industrial IoT is using the IoT in different environments for industrial applications. So you can have them in many, many different environments, what we call the smart star. So it can be cities, healthcare, industry, anywhere. And what we are trying to do is to use standard approach in these different domains, not to redo everything the same time in the different application. What is very tempting, and we already talked about this week, is to have silo approach when you deploy sensors. It means that you have an application in mind, you develop the hardware, and then you deploy your application, and you don't really think about how it will integrate with the evolution of this application or with other applications. So that's what we call the silo approach. So having a look a bit differently of the silo approach is, as I said, you have your application, you develop your hardware that is very specific for what you want to do, and then you have some wireless communication, you just have a modulation, you send this information. And if you do that, it's really quick to the market, because you don't need many development for that, but it's really hard to maintain over time, and it's really hard to integrate other systems when you start developing new application, new wireless communication, and things like that. So what we are working on here is to put internet in the middle of these. So everything will be internet-oriented, right? So you don't have any specificities for the different application you have. All application will use a standard stack, that is the TCP/IP stack. And then you can deploy very easily the data storage, the processing, wherever you want. You can deploy them on site, inside the internet, or in private sites, as you want, or both. Many options are possible as well here. So that's the TCP/IP stack. I think you know this encapsulation mechanism, where in each layer you can... So that's the layer, and each layer adds some overhead with the control information that is used for sending the information. And when you consider the IoT, usually if you want to take the stack as it is, then it's a bit heavy, right? You have this overhead here that is too large for the small data you want to send. And that's only an example, and I think Laurent talked a lot about this, but it's only an example. At all layers, you have some problem with the standard approach, so we need some new development and evolution of these different layers to make it possible to use them over the internet. So there is compression, there is alternative to TCP, there is sometimes different focus. For example, here, the energy becomes very important compared to the standard TCP/IP. So you have many different adaptations that you need. So now let's move forward to the deterministic networking. What is deterministic networking? So let me take an example. In the industry 4.0, for example, it's where you want... There are already existing networks in this environment. And what is new here is that we want to converge these control networks to IP. So we, as I said, we want to put IP in the center to have a reusable technology that you can use for different applications. And we focus especially here in control loops. So these loops that monitor the process and can change the parameter in real time. These control loops need very highly reliable communication, because as I said, when you send a packet, you want to make sure that this packet is going to the other side without any loss. You need also a fixed latency, which means no jitter. So it means that when you send a packet, you want to know before what time it will take to cross the network. And you want to make sure that this time is constant. It never changes if it's the first time you do it or 2 hours later. And then to control all of this, you need, of course, global optimization of all your sensors. And then once you start having the IoT and the standard approach in the factory, then you can go beyond control and automation, and you can have many different sensors that will help you to better optimize your factory using big data and analytics. So what is deterministic networking in a nutshell? It's I know what, I control when, and I can reproduce it every time, guaranteed. Okay? So it usually relies on scheduling and perfect timing. So nodes need to be synchronized, and you need to schedule what's going to happen to make sure that it will happen. Okay? So you need very low loss, which means more than 99.99% of the packet should go to the other side. And a hard bound on the latency, as I said. So what are the technologies that are available? Usually I'm used to separate them in two categories. One is long range. This is more what Laurent talked about 2 days ago. So it looks like cellular network. You deploy antenna that covers usually a large area, like 1 kilometer, square meter, or up to 10, something like this. And it's star topology usually. So it means that the clients, the hear the things, the sensor, directly send the information to the antenna. Okay. And what you can see here is that usually for the IoT they are very low data rate, right? Between few bit per second to 10 kilobit per second, if you want more or less to give numbers. And on the other side, you have short-range technology. You all know Wi-Fi, for example, for device communication, Bluetooth as well. So these are examples of short-range technology. So usually the range is between 10 to 40, 50 meters. And I'm going to focus here on the technology 802.15.4. And that is, why is that? Because it's a technology that recently developed a new access mechanism that I will show, TSCH, that allows to have a scheduling and then to do a planification of the communication you will have. And it's a very cheap technology as well. You can find it everywhere. So it's really easy to use, very cheap. So last time I showed this this stack, we will work on as I said, on the Mac and the network layer from now on. So what are these two layers responsible for? So the link layer, the Mac layer, is responsible for sharing the medium. So it's the layer in which you will decide who can send something and who should receive this something. So you need addressing most of the time and a mechanism, an algorithm to access the medium. So what are the challenges here usually? In the traditional internet, I would say, it's the delay you have once you want to send something, the delay to access the medium and actually sending this thing. And then you can measure the collision probability, the throughput you have, the fairness, how many times you access the medium compared to the other. And with the IoT, we have in top of that the energy consumption, which is really the most important thing here. So how do you manage energy consumption at this layer? There is no magic. Usually, you try to sleep as long as you can. Okay? So when you are sender, it's quite easy to sleep because you know that if you don't have anything to send, you can sleep. Once you want to send something, you can just wake up your radio and access the medium and send your data. The problem is for the receiver. Usually, when you are a receiver, you don't really know when you're going to get something. Okay. So that's something to keep in mind for the what I will show later. Then you have the network layer. What is the network layer? Is that, as I said, it's a short range technology. So you might reach some nodes in your neighborhood, but some others are too far from you. Okay. So for example, in this very simple example, A, if it sends some packets, cannot reach D, okay? Can only reach B and C. So D is out of the coverage of A. So if A want to communicate with D or E or even a node that is further away, it needs some help from the neighbors. So the routing is that A will send to B, and then B obviously will relay to D and so on up to the destination, okay? So let's see now what is TSCH and Ripple for these two layers. So a brief history on 15.4. 15.4 is a very old technology, like it was here, see, like Wi-Fi, for example. It's this more or less the same time they released the two technologies. And they had different way of accessing the medium. So one of them is the easiest one. You don't have any beacons. You don't have any synchronization between the nodes. So it means that when you want to send something, you send it. It's like an Aloha method. But as I said, it's very difficult to sleep here, okay? Because when you are a receiver, you don't really know when you should be awake and receive something. So then you have another method, which is using beacon to synchronize the node. So you send periodically beacons all the time, and you simply define two periods. One is what we call the active one, where you should expect some data, or that's the time you should send your data. And then you have an inactive period just after, here, where nobody should send anything. So it's a way to make nodes sleep, but as you see, it's not very efficient, okay? Because you can only use the medium half the time or the time you decide, okay? And this separation between the two periods are indicated in the beacon. Then you have like an optimization of this. It's instead of having a completely inactive period. You have first still the contention access period, so this is where you can send whenever you want and you should be awake to receive something. And then you have the contention-free period where you have a scheduling here. So you will use this period to schedule what you will send in the following period. And if you are neither a sender or a receiver, you know you can sleep. Okay? And then in 2016, they developed what is called the TSCH. So it stands for time-slotted channel hopping. So let's see what this is. So let's focus on the time-slotted. So let's forget about this dimension and only look at this one. So basically, it's only a scheduler that you define, which means that you defined a frame, which you call a slot frame. And inside the slot frame, you define slot time. So you see the slot time here, T0, T1, T2, T3. And in each of these slot times, you decide who is the sender and who is the receiver. Okay? So it's very easy. When for example, in time slot 1 here, you see A is supposed to send to B. So B should be awake, A should send, and all the other nodes can just sleep. Okay? And then this repeats over time. Okay? So you have the slot frame that goes like this with the different time slot, and then you repeat this slot frame. So periodically you have access to the medium, a guaranteed access to the medium. So you see where I'm going with the deterministic networking. Here I'm starting to have a way to provide a given access to the nodes with a given periodicity. Okay? Now what is the other dimension that I didn't talk yet about? It's a dimension that where you do channel hopping. So 15.4 is working in the 2.4 gigahertz band, and that's an unlicensed band that is shared with many, many devices, including Wi-Fi, for example. So here you have the channel, you have the three most used channel in Wi-Fi, 1, 6, and 11. There are other channels in between, of course. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 13. But these are the most used, like 80% of the devices are deployed on these three channels. And so when you deploy 15.4, which is usually sending at a lower power than Wi-Fi, you need to take care of the interferences, right? Because if you are using the channels that are around here and there is a wireless access point that is operating this area, you may have a lot of interferences, okay? So what I decided to do is to define very narrow channels like this, 16 channels, and to hop all over these channels. But it's a slow hopping scheme, which means that you have one time slot, one channel, and for the next time slot, you will use a different channel. So in that way, you can mitigate and you can adapt to the environment, okay? So how is this working? So as I said, you should look at this dimension this time, where you have what we call the channel offset. And to decide which physical channel you will use, we use a function like this. Because as I said, each time you access the medium, you want to use a different channel. Okay? So in each slot frame that you can see here, that's first slot frame, that's the second one, third and fourth. So in the first one, let's say that you have a communication in time slot 3 with channel offset 1. And you see that because the slot frame is repeating, the next slot frame, you will still have the channel offset 1. Okay? And it's this function that will use the absolute number of your slot time and the channel offset that will give a different physical channel each time. So what you have here is K0 is the first slot frame, let's say. So it's ASN, it's the absolute slot time number, is 3. And you have the channel offset 1. So you should do 3 plus 1, it's 4. Then you look at the lookup table with 4. Okay, so if it's F of 4, you look at here, so it's channel 15. Okay? And then it goes on like this. For the next one, it will be absolute slot time number 10. Yes, 10, because it's the second slot frame time slot number 3, so it's 10. You still have the channel offset 1, so it's going to be F of 11, and F of 11 is somewhere here, 22, channel 22. Okay? And you go on like this. So in this way, you can schedule, as I said, to sum up what we saw here, the different communication that allows the sender and receiver to know when they should expect to receive something. You can avoid the collisions like this, because you know that when it's your turn, then someone else will not send. You can schedule parallel communication as well. It means that if in a given time slot, if A should send to B in for example, channel offset 1, then you can use channel offset 10 for C to D. Okay? So if you are using different channels, you can also use the same time slot. And this is getting close to what we want, deterministic networking, because you can schedule a periodic communication. The only problem you may have here is that if you have some trouble receiving a packet, like a collision or too much interference, you should wait the next slot frame to receive your data if you have a single cell for your communication between A and B. So if A fails to send to B, then it needs to wait the next slot frame, which increases the delay, which is something we don't like. But yeah, I will show you how we can cope with these problems. Now the routing layer. So the routing is extending the coverage of the network because, as I said, you have nodes that have limited coverage. So if they are in the same neighborhood, they can hear each other. But if you want to reach somewhere further, then you need to rely on routing and forwarding. So usually routing is the mechanism in which you will build a topology, a logical topology of your network. You will discover which are your neighbors, and then you will create a forwarding process. Usually you are using dynamic protocols to do that. You don't want to go on the nodes and say, oh, if you want to go to this destination, then goes over this node. You don't want to do that. You want to deploy your sensors. They discover each other, and they learn from the exchanges they make which direction they should forward the packets. One of the most used protocol today, and one of the it was recently developed at the IETF, is called Ripple, RPL, for routing for low power and lossy network. And the concept here is that you will build the route before you need them. So it's called a proactive protocol. And you will try to build this topology here that we called a DODAG, for destination-oriented directed acyclic graph. It means that you define a route of the network, and then all the nodes will learn the next hop toward this route. Okay? So let me show you how it works with an example. So, as I said, you need to define a route of the node, which is most of the time the gateway to exit the wireless network and go on a wire, for example, or a different network at least. And we rely on periodic messages that are called DIO. It's like a hello message. So you start sending in broadcast this DIO message saying, hello, I'm A. And if you receive this, then you know, oh, I'm in the neighborhood of the route, so I can configure my next stop to this one. So you will say, my parent, that's the terminology we use, my parent is A directly. And then B will do the same. It will also It will also forward these hello messages, and all the nodes that are reached by this message will configure the sender as the parent toward the route. Okay? But obviously, at some point of time, you may receive a DIO, a hello message, from someone else while you already know a route to the destination, right? So here, in this case, D learned a route to A, through B. And now he's receiving some information from C. So he should choose. He should choose between B and C, which is the best one toward the destination. Okay? And for that, we use what we call a rank that you can understand like the distance to the route. Okay? So the smaller is your rank, the closer you are to the route. Okay? And you put this information in the periodic messages that you are sending. So let's take an example here. D knew, learned a route to A through B. So his rank, configured based on B's rank, is 920. Then he received a DIO from C, which advertised a rank of 850. Okay. So now you compute the rank you would have using C. And in this example, you end up with 1,100. So if I was using C, I would have a rank of 1,100, okay? Because you add the cost of the link with your neighbor to the rank he advertises himself. Should always increase the rank when you go away from the route. So of course, 1,100 is not interesting compared to 920. So you decide to keep B as the preferred parent. But you can still remember C as a potential parent, okay? You know he has a better rank than you, but you know a better path, let's say that, okay? Then it goes on like this, all the time. So it also allows to maintain the network over time, okay? Because maybe some node can move or can get down, or you may lose a link with a neighbors. So these messages are always sent over and over, okay? And then once everyone knows the parent to the root node, then you know all the routes to the root node, okay? And then if you come back to merging this, combining this with TSCH, the layer that you have below, and then you need to be smart with the scheduling, okay? Because for example, if we consider here a communication from G to E and B and A, then you should schedule the cell in the right order as well. Okay? If you don't do that in the right order, you may need several slot frames to send your packet to the final destination, which you don't usually want. All right. So now what are the remaining challenges? Because you can see here that we can let the nodes auto-organize themselves with Ripple, and we can build a scheduler that allows the node to know when to send. Let's take an example to show you the remaining problems. And these problems are mainly about the delay, variable delay, so the jitter we may have with these technologies. So let's consider this network. You have 2, 4, 6 nodes. And the red arrows are the preferred parent, okay? So 6 is using 4, 4 is using 2, 2 can send to 1, and 5 is using 3, okay? And let's assume we have the source is 6 and the destination is 1, so you start sending to your parent. And let's assume that at one point of time you have a failure or a bad link collision or something like this, okay? So we'll try to send to your preferred parent and you will fail. So as I said, once you fail, what we do usually is retransmission. So you try again, additional delay. And if the node fails, you try again, a given number of times, until you decide, oh, there is too many retransmissions, I should do something about the topology I know. Okay, so I should use an alternative parent, or I should do what is called in Ripple a global repair, when you will start over the entire DDAG. And this takes a lot of time, okay? But even if you do only retransmission, like 2, 3, 4, depending on your scheduler, you may wait for some time, okay? Like 200 milliseconds, 4, 5, it depends the size of the slot frame. But anyway, the delay and so the jitter will increase and the reliability will go down, okay? So we still have a problem here. So what we propose here, and that's more part of our research than really standard stuff and things that exist, we are using packet, what we call packet replication and elimination. So the idea here is to duplicate the packet in the network just to make sure that at least one copy arrive on time. Okay? So the very simple illustration that I can show you here is that you have a source, and instead of sending only to A, your default parent, you will also send to B. You duplicate the packet. So for that, you need to define not only a default parent, but an alternative parent, what we define as an alternate parent. So you have more or less two parents like this. So you send to the default one, you send to the alternate one, and then both of them will forward the packet, okay, toward the destination. And this is where you have elimination, because you need to discard all the copies. Once you receive the first copy, you need to discard all the others, okay? Something else that is quite interesting with that proposal is that because we are using radio, we can use the overhearing feature, which is that even if the packet is not for you, you can still listen to the medium and maybe receive the packet that is sent. And here I'm thinking about the two parents that I selected, A and B. Usually they are both in my neighborhood because I selected them. So while I'm sending to A, then why not B listen to this communication so he has another chance to receive the packet, okay? So in the scheduler, it would look like something like this. So in slot frame one, you have the source that is sending to A, so A is responsible for sending the acknowledgement back, but B can turn on his radio as well and try to receive this packet, okay? And then vice versa, when you are sending to B, you can expect A to be listening the medium and to try to receive the packet. So, for example, if B receives the packet in this time slot, it doesn't matter if there's a collision or a problem in here. He already received the packet here. Okay? So it's another opportunity to receive the data packet with only a single transmission. But we need to be careful with that. Why is that? So let's consider this example of a sensor network with many different nodes and what I would call here layers. And if you don't really pay attention to which parent you select and you let like the default algorithm to select the parent, like you take the best two parents given the RSSI or the ETX, for example, then you end up in something like that. And what is that? It looks like flooding, if you know a bit these things. It means that at the end, you only wanted to duplicate to two, for example. But here what we did is that we include all nodes from this layer. We include all nodes in the forwarding process. And at the end, you have too many copies of the packet. Okay? So we need to find a trade-off between duplicating and not flooding the network. And we want to do that without signaling, if possible, because signaling is additional overhead that we don't want usually in this kind of networks. So to illustrate what we want, it's on the next slide. We want something that is confined in a given path with only two neighbors at each hop or each layer here. Okay, so that's the goal we want to achieve, is to have, you know, the two parents that are related to each other and that both of them have also the same two default parents on the top, okay? So you want to select these two here that have the same default and alternate parents in the above layer, okay? So in that way, you can restrict the number of copies that you have in the network and avoid flooding that is too much for this. So how do we select this alternative parent? So our PhD student defined many different algorithms that are quite complicated to explain. So I will just try to explain the concept of it, because again, we want to minimize the signaling we use. So what we decided to do is to check if the two parents I will select have a common ancestors, okay? So let's see that on an example. So let's consider this topology with a source that has two neighbors, A and B. A is the default parent. Default parent of A is D. Default parent of B is E. But that's not enough to choose which going to be the default, the alternate parent of S. Okay. So what we will do is that we will consider the full set of potential parents. So what is the full set of potential parents? For S, it's A and B. Okay. For A, it's C, D, E. A picked D as the default, but he can listen to C and E. And B as D and E. So I will select B because I see here, I think that's the best picture we could do. You can see that B can listen to D. So I will pick this one because, you know, B has a potential parent that is my default grandparent. Okay? I can match D, which is my default grandparent, with the potential parent of B. Okay? So that's the way I will select the different nodes, by keeping them with overlaps in their potential parent set. Okay? I'm sure it's not very easy to understand this, but we can come back offline if you want me to explain better.
From this picture, it seems there is no other choice anyway.
Exactly. It's a bit bad. You don't have alternative choices. You're right. I should have put B prime and B second to show that we don't select the others because they don't have the overlap in the parent set. It's a good observation. So now, let me show you to finish what we did with that, because we did a lot of implementation. We used, when I say we, I mean Thomas. in the Contiki OS with the CUJA simulator. So that's the scheduler we were using. So just to let you see a bit of what we decided to do here. So it's not like TSCH, okay? In the Y, you have the node idea, and in the X, you have the time slots, okay? And so here we are in the network where node 8 wants to send to node 1, okay? So what did we do? When you have a blue cell, you must send. When you are the green, you should receive. And when you are the yellow, you should overhear. Okay, so here you can see from the scheduler that 8 is the source, 7 is the default parent, and 6 is the alternate parent. Okay, and what I did here is that we are sending 2 times to the default parent. We prefer to schedule 2 potential transmissions if the first one fails, because we don't want to wait the next slot frame to do a retransmission if needed. Okay. So we decided to allocate 2 time slots for a single transmission, if you want. So if you succeed in sending in the first time slot, you won't send in the second one, okay? And then in slot time 2, you do the same with the alternate parent, right? So you send to 6, and 7 should listen as well if it didn't receive the first 2 time slots, okay? So then you do that all over for all the layers, for all the ops. And at the end, you have the time slot 20, 21, 22, 23, where you have the 2 neighbors of the destination that have the opportunity to send to the root of the network. Okay, so each time, more or less whatever happens in the network, you will receive the copy in these 4 time slots. So the maximum jitter is only 3 time slots. Either you receive, in the best case scenario, you receive it in the first time slot. In the worst case, you receive in the 4th, which is the... So best case is 20, and worst case is 23. Okay? That's how the results look like. Maybe I won't explain everything. In red, it is standard Ripple, and in green, it's what we propose. And for these 2 colors, you have different versions. I don't think it's useful that I enter into the details. So that's for the reliability, which means you send 100 packets. How many of them get to the destination? Okay. So you see that more or less all of them works well. You have what is noticeable is this one. And this is default Ripple with no retransmissions. So you have a single shot and you never try again. So you can see here that even with a link that is 90% good, you have like 70% of the packet that goes to the other way. Okay? But if you allow for the standard approach, Ripple, two retransmissions, then you see you are already close to 100%. Okay? For LFC, what we propose here, you let's forget about this first option. It was without overhearing. So if you are using overhearing, you are always around 100%. But we didn't do... that was not the main objective. The main objective, again, was to have a constant delay. So let's look at the delay. So that's the end-to-end delay. And you can see here that we decrease the delay by more than half. Okay, that's because in Ripple, when you do retransmissions, you need to wait the next load frame to do that. And if you look more closely at the jitter, we have no jitter with our approach. Okay, the jitter you can barely see, it's really close to zero. Because as I told you, it's in the four time slot at the end that you receive the information. There's a cost for that, of course, and that's the power consumption. Okay, because you need more retransmissions, there are more nodes that are involved in the forwarding. So of course you consume more energy. But nothing comes with magic. Okay? And we believe that these, if you need some quality of service, then you also need to spend some energy to have it. So you can see here that you more or less you double a little bit more than this, you double the energy you consume compared to the standard approach Ripple, okay? That's all I wanted to say today. Thank you for listening.
Okay, thank you. So some question, I know you're angry, but we can have time for
angry
some question.
Angry or hangry?
Angry.
You have one in the, he didn't see you.
Okay, thank you for the presentation. I wanted to ask you about how the ranking of the link is set. And the ranking, does it, is it related to just the local link between two nodes, or is it depending on how will it go to the destination, the rest of the route?
Well, there are a lot of works on that. There are different, what they call, objective functions to define the rank, so to compute the rank. And usually, you take the rank of your parent and you add something. And the objective function is how you add something. So let me give you an example. An example could be you take the rank and then you add the ETX, so the average number of time you need to send a packet to the node before you succeed. So you take this number and you add it to the rank. So that's one example. You can also, based on the number of hops to the destination, things like that. So you what is quite nice in this protocol is that they don't correlate the metric you use, the function, and the protocol itself. So you can use whatever function you want to compute the rank and what metric you want to compute it.
If I may ask another one. So about the frequency hopping, may you just maybe elaborate the advantage of it and why you said it's a slow frequency hopping and I did not get the advantage of that.
Because for example, if you have technologies like Bluetooth, you do frequency hopping with it a single transmission. So it means you hop from one channel, you have a sequence of channels and in the same transmission, you hop with the receiver with over these channels. Here we say it's a slow frequency hopping because you use a single channel for a single entire transmission. And why is that? It's because we know that the wireless environment is polluted and we don't really know what it is. So instead of learning which are the best channels, we just use them more or less randomly. So Yorgos, for example, did some research on blacklisting some channels depending where you are and stuff like this. But more or less, the idea is to use diversity. So you try one, then next time you use another one, and so on.
Yeah.
Hi, thank you very much for the presentation. My question is really very generic. I want to know what you think about combining TSCH and LoRa, for example, because I...
I'm smiling because it's a new topic, I think, that emerged 1 year ago or something like this.
Yeah, because right now what I'm working on is, you know, the other day I was asking you, LoRa have a star topology, so it means you send from sensor to the gateway. But I still want to be able to communicate between sensors anyway. So that means at the bottom, I would need maybe a short range communication protocol. So do you think it's feasible to use TSH and LoRa in an industrial setting?
I don't think I have an answer to this. I may have an opinion, but definitely not an answer, because you have to look at the application you want and the technology itself. Because if you want to have a scheduler, then there is a lot of overhead that I didn't show here. But you need to keep time synchronization, and you need to define the scheduler and push the scheduler into the nodes. And if you look at LoRa, for example, it was not made for that. LoRa was made for, oh, I need to send one packet in a day or in a week. You sleep all the time, you wake up and you send it. You don't care about time synchronization and things like that. So it depends on the power you are ready to spend to provide this and the quality you need at the end.
I will just add some, I will not be neutral here. Something about LoRa, you have to make the difference between LoRaWAN and LoRa. So LoRa is a physical layer, and you have a lot of channels that you can use, and maybe if you have all the stuff said by Nicolas, then you can do frequency hopping or something like SysTish. LoRaWAN is restrict the physical layer of LoRa, which means that you can now use only 3 channels, and it's very centralized. So it's a MAC layer, and this MAC layer cannot be used for things like 6dish. But the physical layer, maybe, yeah.
No, plus the duty cycle.
Yes, you have duty cycle, but it's if you don't have a lot of traffic, it can be used. Yes, another question, or you want to say something for lunch?
We can go for lunch soon. You said it already that the channel hopping at the moment is more or less using a random channel. And do you think it will be promising, or is it promising, or are there works done using AI to predicting the channel loads on the channels and doing that? And how much gain do you think could you get through that? Because it obviously has a cost, because you have to run this learning and so on. So do you consider it promising? Will it be something that we see in 10 years every protocol is using that? Or is it more like, well, it will have a little gain, but it's not worth the effort?
You want to answer? He works. I'm asking him because he worked a lot on this, so maybe he has a better answer than me.
So yes, there are many research papers on machine learning, more specifically reinforcement learning, on how to select the channel based on quality, based on the location, geographical, etc., obstacles. And yes, there are many companies, they already made patents on how to use which channel to select. The pattern, first, second, third, etc. So how to jump from one channel to another. We know already, because we are working with them, some companies already made some patents. Pardon?
How is this recording?
It's essential, up to 10, maybe 15, maybe 20%. It's essential, yeah, because you have some channels like providing 20% or 50% link quality. So it's like you're losing 1 out of 2 packets, right? So if you're moving towards the above 8% link quality channels, then your throughput increases. But the problem then is the network capacity. So the more you blacklist, so the more you reduce the available channels to transmit, then you have less parallel transmissions. So the problem is that you're reducing the overall network capacity. Okay.
But would you say that so it helps like getting from the about 20% network efficiency towards more 100% per entire bandwidth that is available? Because when you use Ethernet, for instance, you, at the moment, then you have you only use a certain portion of the available bandwidth of the channel. So would you say that you get to a better usage of the channels through the AI? And second question, is the gain coming through that no one else is doing at the moment, this AI optimization, or do you think when everybody is doing AI optimization, it will be as bad as it is today?
So this is what I said earlier. It's at the end, you end up having a trade-off. So if you're everybody are going to use reinforcement learning to find which channel is the best, by definition, you are reducing the number of efficient channels. So whenever they're focusing there, again, you are increasing your, let's say, interference and the collisions potentially that you may have. And then you drop your good channels, and then you'll have to go back.
That's clear, but when you take all the channels at the moment, then you're not at 100%.
I'm not sure if I'm getting your question. So, I mean, if you are doing this blacklisting, so in TSS you have 16 radio channels, right? So if you're doing the reinforcement learning, by definition, you're focusing on the best, let's say, five that you want to use. And so you're having 11 channels that you are not using anymore in your network, in your private network.
But for someone else who starts later, the optimization might be to use some other five channels. Because, I mean,
You mean another network, or you mean another node within the same network?
Maybe another network that is using the same spectrum, or maybe this is not happening, I don't know.
So we are talking about here more... Most of the time, we are talking about private networks for industrial.
No.
So it's you are having going there with 200 or 300 devices within a specific zone. So you're having your own network, so which is dedicated for you.
Okay.
And then each device does its own reinforcement learning.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
I have. That's enough for me. So other questions or? Yeah. And after that, we will close. And
you don't want to eat.
Yes. And you can discuss on the way to the restaurant.
Just a quick one, because like building on the AI question, I wonder if like there is a central entity that could like compute or predict which channels should we use, and then there would be an extra network traffic to inform all the nodes that this will be the sequence of the channels that we're going to use. I don't know if this is a drawback that is considerable, or it's not a problem.
Well, for the channel you will use, I think that usually you embed the function in the devices. So you decide beforehand what function you will use, and then it's the node that compute given the environment.
Okay.
But of course, you have all possible solutions. You can also have the nodes that report to a central entity that pushes again the decision or whatever.
Okay. So I think we leave the discussion on the way to the restaurant. Thank you.
Okay, very good. So this was the last technical talk of the summer school. And now we'll go to the Kobe again, where we've been the last 2 days. We'll have lunch there. And after lunch, we'll return here, and then you can work on the challenges. Not enough people started working on the wall yet. I just want to remind you that you're able to work there. We also have a photo printer where you can print the photos, and we also have the other printer that I used yesterday, no, the day before. There where you can also